after he appeared to his followers from Jerusalem, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. He showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas, called the Twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it. Now they were not able to haul it in, because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. The other disciples came in the boat, dragging a net full of fish, for they were not far from land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you've just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he had said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." After this, he said to him, "Follow me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You would pull out your Bibles. If you have brought them, or if not, there are some in the pew. And you're welcome to write in the pew Bibles if you use a pencil. And you can write whatever you want in your Bibles. To open to John chapter 21. Really good thing. Peter is still wrestling with what happened not that long ago when he denied his Lord 3 times. His shame had led him here to this moment, onto familiar waters. Though Peter and those with him were expert fishermen, they didn't catch a thing all night. And as faith breaks, the text explains that Jesus shows up and does a miracle. Peter, upon realizing who this man is, jumps in the water and rushes to his Lord, despite the shame in his heart. In verse 9, it mentions that Jesus had prepared a meal for them over a charcoal fire. Now I want you to circle or underline this term in verse 9, charcoal fire. For even though it doesn't seem very important, the only other time a charcoal fire was mentioned in John's Gospel, Peter was warming his hands on it when he denied his Lord. And this simple detail sets the stage for Jesus' confrontation with Peter in verse 15. Now there's something fascinating I find in this exchange between Peter and Jesus. I never really realized the depth of the dialogue until I looked into the words being translated. In the Greek language, there are 4 different words used for love. Where in this text we just read the word love, there's a lot more to it than we realize. So in your Bibles, I want you to circle the words love in verses 15 through 17. There's a couple of them. The 2 Greek words used for love here between Peter and Jesus are phileo and agape. Now, phileo is a common term used for brotherly love, where agape refers to a selfless and purposeful love. And this love is found throughout Scripture almost exclusively for God talking about his love for his people, which is an intense kind of love. Now, using these 2 Greek words for love, this is how the exchange may have sounded.
Simon, son of John, do you agape me more than these? Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Simon, son of John, do you agape me? Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Simon, son of John, do you phileo me? Lord, you know everything, you know that I love you.
So twice Jesus asks, do you agape me? And twice Peter responds that he phileos him. The final time Jesus says, do you phileo me? And Peter matches. Now, if you translate the Greek into present-day dialogue, this might be what the conversation sounded like.
Peter, do you love me unconditionally? I love you, Lord. Peter, do you love me sacrificially and purposefully? I love you, as a brother. Peter, do you love me with affection as a brother? Lord, you know it, I love you, brother.
So Peter is unable to say the word agape. Yet here Jesus is not looking down on him, frustrated at his inability to match verbs or the truth behind them. Instead, Jesus is meeting Peter where he is at the level in which he came, erasing his shame and recommissioning him to feed his lambs, his children, and to feed and tend his sheep, his people. This passage has become very personal to me over the past few months, before I was asked to preach on it. There have been a lot of friends in my life who are currently struggling, battling their own personal sword. It often feels to me like they are in a locked room of their struggles, and I'm standing beside them, holding the key, the answer to their struggles. I feel like I know the answer to erase their struggles. If they would just let go of that person, or confront someone with how they're feeling, or admit to themselves the truth that they are unable to see. But after standing beside them, my outstretched hand growing weary of holding that key that they aren't taking from me, I realize something. I cannot make them take that key, telling them how to handle their situation. They haven't taken the key from me because they need to discover the solution for themselves, and the key that fits best for them, no matter how long that takes. And it is in this place that we as individuals are at the crossroads. We can walk away from those people who don't seem to listen to us when we try to help,
challenge a biblical model. Jesus again and again meets people where they are at, in their conflicts and struggling and pain and darkness, and walks beside them. This can be seen through the lens of Jesus' entire ministry. He went to the lepers, the tax collectors, the hated in society. He met Nicodemus in the dark night where he was ashamed to be seen with him. And even when he called his first disciples, he met them in what they knew, fishing. And he offered them a choice between fishing for fish or fishing for people. And here Jesus is meeting Peter in his phileo love and accepts the love that Peter is giving and recommissions him to go out into the world and to spread his message, knowing what Peter can be and encouraging him as he walks alongside him. I believe that this gospel passage speaks to the heart of human character. There are times when we are all filled with that darkness or shame or guilt or pain. But following in the likeness of Jesus, we are called to meet people in that place and to walk alongside them and to never give up or abandon them. Peter rose from his shame and became a great leader of Christ's message to his people. And we can do the same, walking beside each other and standing beside one another. On the Delaware River, I eventually got my kayak off those rocks, even though it took a lot longer than I had hoped. And I found my friend waiting for me around the bend, and we paddled the rest of the way, side by side. As Ram Dass once said, we're all just walking in